Hello there, I'm Lee from Educative. Welcome to Educative Sessions. If you like this episode, please be sure to click the like button below wherever it may be. Also, don't forget to subscribe and get reminders on future content. Enjoy. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Educative Sessions, a podcast series with people in the developer world about their coding experiences. This is brought to you by Educative, which makes it easy for authors to provide interactive and adaptive courses for software developers. My name is Li Ngo, and I am the host of Educative Sessions. And today I'm interviewing Alex Nguyen, who keeps interviewing even though he's landing some really, really great jobs. Alex, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you for having me. Yeah, it's great to be here.
Yeah, so I'm a bit, I'm gonna let you talk about where you work and where you've worked in the past on your end. All I want to say is you worked at some very impressive places so far. Let's go to the very beginning. You're fresh out of university. What is the first like place that you ended up working, and how did you land that situation?
My first role out of university, right in 2019, right, was at Amazon. So where when I started, I actually didn't have any internships, or I didn't have a lot of opportunities to learn how to really apply to a new grad opportunity or a first job as an engineer. A lot of these were challenges for me, but what I found was actually a little helpful for me personally, and this was by chance, was that in school, I had a few classes where it was a project-related coursework. I think I did one of the slide things where I put a lot of those projects on my resume, and that got my foot
Smart.
in the door.
That's very smart. Yeah.
I hope so. I don't know if those count as personal side projects or not, but I put them on there, and then they gave me a chance. What I would like to say is, like, this was the only opportunity that I had at the time, and I had to jump on it. I wasn't going to let this one slip by. So that's how I kind of landed my first gig at Amazon.
Well, I think that's very it's very astute of you to identify that because, in my own work of supporting people getting into the field, like the first thing you learn is it's not really so much about where you've gone in the past. It's more like what can you do now? And what in a space of inspiration, what kind of things can you create? And that becomes very project oriented. What's your GitHub look like, et cetera. Those are the kinds of questions that start out. And so you started off there, and it's a great situation. Many people would, dream of ended up at a company like that. But from there, what was your plan, right? Did you hope to grow and stay in the organization, or did some other idea come in mind?
I think a lot of people can agree with me that when you think about what a software engineer does, they code, right? And it's something that we have to think about. Am I coding enough in my role? And something I want a lot of people to think about is, in your role, are you coding enough? Because there's a lot of responsibilities of being a software engineer, and it's more than just coding. It could be how many meetings you're in. It could be, are you writing documentation on why something broke or why something failed? Like, why did AWS go down? If you spend way too much time doing that, I felt like, for me personally, my coding expertise was not where I wanted it to be.
So I'm gonna ask you, boldly, sorry to interrupt you, but documentation is an important part of being in a software developer, but you actually think software or documentation was holding you back a little bit? Is that just to clarify? Wow, that's
It's
bold.
interesting that you asked that, because I think a common interview question that you might get on a recruiter is how much of your day do you spend coding? And I think for me, if it's less than 50%, it's not enough. When I was at Amazon, I think it was way too much documentation on, like, what went wrong and the issues that were happening that I didn't get most of my data code. I think I was distracted with meetings and just learning all the internal tooling. I felt like I spent about 30% of my day coding, and I was worried if that was holding me back.
So, I mean, to be frank, in our prior conversation, I thought you were mostly motivated by money, but it sounds like you were actually motivated by personal development, right? And so how did you go and seek out opportunities to ensure that you would continue to grow as a software developer?
Oh yeah, definitely. So something I was thinking about was, is this normal? Is this really what a software engineer does, right? And what I was learning over time is that the title software engineer is very different from company to company. And the way I like to explain this is kind of like how you can go from like going from a company where you're not coding at all to a company where all you do is coding, right? And that kind of like sparked my interest to start looking around and start seeing like, okay, throw an application out to a good number of companies to see what's out there, what does this role look like? Is what I'm doing now the end all be all of like what a software engineer is? And the only way I could really learn that is if I put myself out there and looked around. That's kind of what spun and led me to my next role at Microsoft. So it's very interesting that over there, the title was still the same, software engineer, but my role was completely different. All I did there was code. It was very limited on what we call a postmortem. So where we're detailing, talking about issues that happened before. So after I was spending 80% of my day coding in that role, which was such a huge difference, and that's where I started to feel more like a full-fledged software engineer, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, I think that's cool that that transition was able to happen for you, right? But was that satisfactory for you? I mean, I'm under the impression you didn't actually spend a lot of time in that position. That it was it a grass is always greener kind of thing, or was there some other factor or some other realization that happened that perhaps motivated you to look elsewhere in your career?
It's a little bit of it of the grass is always greener. I'm looking at other companies thinking like, how different is this? Am I enjoying the work that I do? And am I valued the same way in every role? I like to think about it with this really simple example. Like a water bottle, you can get one at Costco for 25 cents. You can go to the supermarket and get one for $1, and you can go to the airport and get one for $4, which is ridiculous. But it's the same water bottle. I feel the same way about being an engineer. I could work at one company, I'm valued at a certain amount. When I was at Amazon, my compensation was 150,000. I moved to Microsoft and I'm still a software engineer. I'm doing the same thing that I'm doing, but my compensation rises up to $185,000. And knowing that I am under the same title, I have the same skill set, I'm applying the same things that I already know, but different places are valuing me at a different rate. And I wanted to make sure that for me, I'm making take or getting on top of the best opportunity for myself financially. That was kind of the mindset that I built just moving around.
Forgive me, I love metaphors and I want to run with this a little bit more because I know I've purchased water pretty much in every single scenario. And as someone who I travel a little bit and I've always purchased water, knowing in my mind, oh, this is so expensive. I don't want to do this. But that's not what's happening there. And it sounds like in a lot of ways, the scenario where you are purchasing water is really more about a scenario where you want to feel critical to the mission. You want to feel like you're close and like therefore whatever you're doing is valuable. So, how did that come into your brain? Like as you were working for one place where you're getting paid more and you're doing more software development and you're working more, how did you identify for yourself that this was a need that you needed to pursue?
A need that I need to pursue. Just maybe I could use a little bit more clarity on that question.
Sure, fine. Okay, yeah, I mean, well, I mean, in short is, you went from going from Microsoft to your current position now, and you can tell us a little bit more about that journey, whether it was like this is good, but maybe it wasn't what I thought it was going to be, and now I want to be somewhere where my own personal value is maximized, right? That could be one theory. Or was it, you could have also been scouted as well. Like, I'd love to know a little bit more about how you made that second leap.
So it's interesting that you asked. Yes, I was scouted. The first week after I joined Microsoft, I get a recruiter call from the company that where I would soon to join Google, asking would I be interested in joining. And I was honest with them. Like I just got here. This is probably I gotta stay somewhere for a little bit. So give me
Welcome to
another
the tech
year.
life. I mean, this is not uncommon. No, it's not uncommon at all.
Yeah, I'm like, how do you even know I just switched? I'm like, what makes you think I'm ready to move again? But yeah, so what ends up happening is that over the year, I told them to come back later. I didn't think they'd actually do it, right? And in between, I keep getting more people reaching out to me, more recruiters reaching out to me, like, hey, would you be interested in applying? I think the like a, an average or it's pretty normal for a lot of people to kind of ignore or like dismiss a lot of these chats or opportunities. They're like, I just got here. I think I flipped it the other way. I try to get on top of any opportunity to like interview where they presented themselves from like tiny startups to other larger companies to things that are like in between. They're like just like nudging the way over. So I wasn't always sure if this was something I was going to jump ship for, right, when I first saw the opportunity. But I think for me, I was just trying to see what was out there, because I've learned when I was in my little Amazon box, I didn't know how big the world software engineering looks like and where I could be as an engineer.
That's a fair answer. And I mean, it's such a, forgive me, it's such a ego inflating thing to essentially be scouted for such a long period of time, but also validating because, from what I've seen of you, you're not a shy person when it comes to the things you're doing and what you're working on. And I think those things go a mile away. Like extroverted coders are, I would dare say, have a high propensity for success because they are showing what they're capable of doing. And in this day of making of how difficult it is to actually find great talent, you're not one to shy away from those opportunities. So let's, as we come to the near end of this discussion, this is very impressive to me on a personal level. Like I'm someone who largely has hoped to seek opportunities from within a company and I love to actually grow and develop things from within and try to be patient. But some of my friends know that's kind of a lie, because even in this, when I lived in the same city you lived in now, a lot of the times I had to seek better opportunities by looking elsewhere. And so I want to have a, if you were willing, a candid conversation about what it takes for people to find their true value out in the market and what your recommended strategies are when it comes to really discovering their the height of their own worth.
Oh yeah, of course. So some advice I would give to people who are looking for their true value. So I think there's like two components that people need to think about is, are they learning or are they earning, right? And then they have to figure out like which one's a little bit more important for them in any place and time. We could start talking about the earning portion first. So if we want to talk about earning, what could happen is, I don't want people to start practicing for interviews when they need to, right? For a lot of people, they don't get into the grind again, and they're not prepared until they're thinking about making a transition. I know when I was like starting my first gig at Amazon, I felt like, yeah, I got the interview process over with. I never have to think about this again. But things change, the economy changes, your interests change, your role, what you thought it was, changes. And I have to think about like, where do I want to be next? So I kind of consistently keep interviewing and trying to like practice. Now the follow-up portion of that is when you're trained and conditioned to practice a little bit more, I think you open yourself up to more opportunities and you get to see a little bit more about like what's out there. One of those opportunities is learning how to negotiate a little bit more. So I'm a big advocate of learning how to negotiate a little bit more and learning like the ins and outs of it, because I find it to be like the easiest way to kind of like bolster your compensation, right? You can do it with like a little 30-minute email more than you could do it with like a 6 months in performance with a performance bonus, right? So that's all I'm really thinking about when how can you really bolster your compensation for yourself? Just learning out all these things.
These are, different kinds of tactics in what most software developers are taught, right? It's mostly just build, perform, do well, make things happen. But I find that especially I want to add like that it's like especially during these preliminary processes, yeah, you can do so much within a simple discussion. And those are the times where your ability to capture as much value are optimal, like in the early conversations. It might just be very frank. I mean, I want to boldly put it out there that most companies, from whatever stage they are, I mean, just the almost logic of companies is they want to bring you in And then once you're in, like the incentive for them to, continue to give to you is flattened a little bit, right? They already have you in the company. But like in that moment of from before you're out to you're in is just a huge moment for the person applying for the job. And you seem like someone who knows this very well. Where did you learn how to do this? That's what I want to know. Where did you become both a seemingly skilled software developer, but a shrewd negotiator?
Oh yeah. So with the companies that I've interviewed with, and it's really interesting, what ended up happening was sometimes with the offers I did have, I would try little things that I wanted to learn what I could negotiate on. Can I negotiate with 401k? Can I negotiate with PTO? How effective can I negotiate with a competing offer? Do I actually have to give a number first? Right? That one was the biggest one that actually surprised myself that you actually don't, or in my experience, I didn't have to once. And it was really amazing to see how far that negotiating process looked, just saying that I haven't thought about this and I want you to give me your best offer and we'll work from there.
Yeah, these are bold moves, but like I would recommend literature on negotiation tactics. And I don't know if you ever have any, even have any of your own, Alex, like to recommend. I think that would be great for a lot of people who are really looking for the next step, right? Do you have any that like, or is this stuff you all learned on the fly?
Yeah, so if let me or please let me know if I really enjoyed Never Split the Difference, so that was a personal book that's really exciting for a lot of people. One of my favorite stories from that one is there was a group of people, and I want to share this because I'm sure it'll help a lot of people. There were a group of people in a hostage situation, and they were demanding like $1 million in ransom or 500,000, some absurd number, right? And eventually the negotiator would ask them like, why? So just because we want to throw a party. So they gave him 5,000 instead, right? Yeah, so it was one of
Yeah,
those
I'm
examples.
familiar with that book, and I actually have read it a few times. But it's a but like that's a fantastic question. Is a lot of the times like everything's up for negotiation, everything is flexible, and at the same time, it's good to find out. I think especially for people who are in technology like yourselves, that you have so much potential, right? I think that's important. I mean, I don't want to suddenly turn this into like a super revolutionary talk where everyone's starting to like, rage quit over like the bad deal that they struck a long time ago. Or maybe they should, I don't know. But at the very least, I hope that people have been inspired by, your confidence and also your I think there's a lot of wisdom that can be gained here. So Alex, come to the end of all the questions that I have for you. And honestly, I have so many more, but I want to be respectful of time. I'd love to give you an opportunity to do what we call is a shameless plug. Like, is there anything that you'd like to talk about that's either from your personal work or even from your community? The floor is yours. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm pretty active on LinkedIn. If anyone's interested in connecting with me, my LinkedIn's always open to anyone who's interested.
All right, very cool, very cool. I am connected. I'm very proud to be. Thank you very much. But this has been really an awesome talk, and honestly, I would love to continue these kinds of conversations because, yeah, like this is important. Whether you're in tech or maybe you're just learning how to get into these amazing companies and negotiate with your own deals, there's a lot of wisdom to be gained here. So thank you so much, Alex, for being on the show. And I also want to thank you for watching this on YouTube or listening to this on any major podcasting apps. You can learn more about of our opportunities by checking out Educative at educative.io. And so just to wrap up for all of us here at Educative, thank you so much and happy learning. Bye-bye now. Hello there. Lee here from Educative. Hope you enjoyed this latest episode with Educative Sessions. If you like this episode, please click on the like button somewhere. You can find more episodes on YouTube or on any major podcasting app. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. It actually helps us a lot. Happy learning.